From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
I'm Ron Charles, editor of Book World at the Washington Post, which is a charter sponsor of the National Book Festival. Our guest this morning is Marilynne Robinson, one of the most celebrated writers and teachers in America. President Obama has referred to her as a friend and said her writings have fundamentally changed me. It's hard to get a blurb from the president, but she has one. In 2012, a laudatory essay in the New Yorker began by observing, Marilynne Robinson has published only 3 novels in a career spanning more than 30 years, but each of them is a masterpiece. He was talking about her first novel, Housekeeping, which was a finalist for the 1980 Pulitzer Prize, and then her 2 stunning novels about a small town in Iowa. Gilead, one of my favorite novels, was published in 2004 and won the National Book Critics Circle Award and the Pulitzer Prize. She went on to return to that town again in 2008 with a novel called Home, which was a finalist for the National Book Award. And then last year, she published another extraordinary story about Gilead called Lila, which again won the National Book Critics Circle Award. In addition to her own work, she has helped guide some of the finest young fiction writers in the country at the Iowa Writers' Workshop, where she's taught for many years. And she sometimes preaches at a Congregational United Church in Iowa City. In fact, her name is always invoked in discussions about the treatment of religion and faith in American fiction. Thank you so much for being here today.
Well, it's a great honor. Happy to be here.
Were your parents writers or big novel readers?
No, actually not at all. what can I say? They just didn't read fiction.
They didn't read fiction at all.
Mm-mm. And they didn't write anything but letters to relatives, which I'm sure were very nice letters.
Did you grow up expecting to be a novelist? What made you think of that as a potential career?
I started writing poetry and so on long before I had any idea that you could be a professional writer. Dickens was like something that was on a book in order to tell me what to expect of the contents. You know, the fact that he was an actual historical figure that dawned on me after I'd read most of his work. I did write poetry sort of imitatively because I read poetry. Nice. My poetry was considerably worse than the poetry I was imitating. I've always liked language. I've always liked writing, when I was in college, I became fascinated with a certain kind of metaphorical writing that you find in 19th century American writers particularly. And so I spent some time while I was working on a dissertation writing these metaphors just to make sure my hand was still in a way. And then when I was done with the dissertation and I looked at all these things together, there weren't so many of them, I realized it was the beginning of a novel. And I wrote the novel, but I thought it was unpublishable. I almost meant it to be unpublishable.
What do you mean by that?
Well, for one thing, at that time, it was fairly unusual to write a book that had only female characters. Also, I was very aware of it as a sort of language experiment as much as anything. Well, it was many things to me. I was obviously very invested in it, I think. But at that time, also, it seemed to me as if that was a past tradition of literature that I...
But you were too late.
Well, I wasn't thinking about... I have a friend who had published a novel and therefore had the name and address of an agent. And he took my manuscript without telling me. I mean, he told me he had it, but he didn't tell me what he was going to do with it, which is send it to his agent. And so, out of a blue sky, I got a letter from an agent saying, I'm very happy to represent your book. It will be very hard to place. She is my agent to this day.
one of my favorite writers, and as I said, Gilead's one of my very favorite novels, so I hope you don't mind my asking, but are you surprised that these quiet, difficult, theologically infused novels have found such a large and impassioned audience?
I think that there's a certain tendency to write down to an imagined readership. I think people are very smart and very serious. I tell my students, you know, assume your reader is smarter than you are. Assume your reader is a better human being than you are.
Religion and faith so rarely make a meaningful appearance in literary fiction, unless, of course, it, you know, it's fanaticism or abusive priests or kind of gooey spirituality. Why is that?
It's an interesting thing. People always say, you know, it's so surprising to make a, you know, create a minister who's a positive character. You know, and really, that is true if you look at American literature. And at the same time, Americans, I find, often very deeply attached to a minister.
You mean in real life?
In real life. And, you know, you walk through an American city, there's a church on this corner, a church on the next corner, a church on the next corner. And these things, you know, they're sustained by the fact that people love them.
Right.
And I think that our national character, such as it is divided in many strange ways. And one of them is that we tend to ridicule what we value. And I think that it makes life a little bit difficult for us because it makes us inarticulate about the things that we really do value. Frankly, I think that we value goodness in people. I think it's a pretty thing, a handsome thing that is the product of self-discipline and thought, you know. And we tend to treat representations of people who seem to be good as if they're hypocrites, you know, as if they're really up to something bad, you know. I don't know why we do that. We have to put a little thorn in everything, you know, or a big one. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in what I see, which is very different from what we tend to represent.
Reading your novels makes me realize what I don't usually see in fiction, which is something very intimate, which is prayer. We know tens of millions of Americans tell us they pray every day, mm-hmm. but it rarely shows up in a novel. Mm-hmm. Rarely. Why is that so taboo? Why is that kind of intimacy the only kind of intimacy left that we can't read about?
Right, right. Well, you know, we tell ourselves that we have a realist tradition of literature, but that doesn't really mean that our realism is attentive to reality. It means that it's obedient to certain conventions of representing, you know. And I would be fascinated to read more that seem to actually draw on what people do and experience and value. That we don't have to be told that we're flawed creatures. We know that, we see it continuously in everything that we do. But if we're going to be realists, we should talk about reality, and that does include things like prayer, and it does include things like actual admiration for people who show us how to live well, you know?
Do you feel self-conscious or anxious about setting a novel like that out into an audience, out into a culture that ridicules those kind of subjects?
I've really never cared about that. You know, there was that long space between Housekeeping and the other, and I read a lot during that time, and I read, you know, history. I read centuries of history, as much from primary sources as I could manage, and so on. And, you know, I'm very interested in simply the world, the absolute world. I don't care about ridicule. I could very well have been ridiculed, you know, but I don't want to spend years writing something that is simply a kind of defensive cringe against attitudes that I hope I don't engage in and that I don't particularly admire.
When you started Gilead, did you have the whole trilogy in mind?
No. I always always promised myself that I wouldn't write a sequel, and I don't think I have, actually.
You called it a companion with home.
Yeah, well, yes.
So you write Gilead. It's a tremendous success. Mm-hmm. Then home came to you separately?
Well, actually, when I did readings and things, I found that people were always asking me about characters. And the thing is that when you write a novel, you have spent, you know, years typically with these imaginary people that you become very fond of, you know, very deeply emotionally engaged with. You feel as though you know them. You're ignoring your own family. And then, for my experience at least, is that the novel ends itself. At a certain point, it's just telling you, this is where we wind down, you know? And so after all this long time of obsessive interest in these non-existent people, they're gone. And it feels, if you miss them, you know? So I had that experience very strongly after Housekeeping. I thought it was like mourning, you know? But I waited and waited and waited until they were sort of out of my mind. But when I had finished Gilead and I had the same experience, I thought, why am I doing this? If they're still alive in my mind, let them have their book, you know?
Now, your newest novel focuses on a character we saw in Gilead, but we didn't really get to know that much, a Reverend John Ames' wife. And in Lila, we learn she has this extraordinarily difficult childhood of abandonment and horrible poverty and sometimes even, you know, scrounging for food. Did you know all that about her when you wrote Gilead, that she'd had such a difficult childhood?
I did, in a sense. You know, the character of John Ames and the character of Robert Bowden are both very highly acculturated, very refined products of a particular theological tradition, and so were their fathers, and so were, you know, and I have all the admiration in the world for these lovely traditions, at the same time that the exclusivism of any tradition sort of bothers me, you know, and I was very happy to create a character that I did not have to think of as being acculturated in that sense at all. Mm-hmm. Having a different palette, a different possibility of drawing theological conclusions.
Yes. She knows nothing about his tradition.
Exactly.
She knows, doesn't know the stories.
Exactly.
She hears them in such a fresh, sometimes funny way. She takes them very, very seriously.
Yes, yes. Trying to join the conversation, you
right.
know. But I think that when I was reading the Old Testament, thinking about her, how it would look to her, one of the things that was very striking to me is that the poor, the people, the sort of the people that are rarely individually named or noticed, are what the book is actually about. And the prophets and the, you know, the kings and all the rest of it, they come and go. They succeed or they fail, but the measure of the success is always, are you looking after my sheep, you know? Are you looking after the people? And I thought, you know, we make the mistake routinely of identifying with the powerful people, but she would identify with the people who are the unnamed on the landscape, you know, whose well-being is of the primary interest to God.
It makes her a very fresh listener of the Bible.
That was what I hoped for.
And their relationship, I mean, it is so sweet and so surprising. Don't you think? I mean, she's much younger. Mm-hmm. They have nothing in common. You can't blame the townspeople for kind of gossiping about these two. And he wasn't even really looking for a wife.
Right.
He wasn't looking for love. How could they get together? How did you think of their relationship?
Well, you know, I think that as, even as perhaps as people mature or as they age, they become quite good at reading the lives of the people that they see. They know, you know, I mean, I think that she's a strong, estimable, innocent woman. And I think that he can see that in her, and he can see loneliness in her, and which he can answer in kind, of course. That I think that sort of affinity that is not based on the narrative of an individual life, but based on the character that has emerged, you know, despite or because of or whatever it is, you know.
Then she brings out his oddness too. Mm-hmm. She says, "You are the strangest man," whereas he didn't seem strange to us before. To her, of course, she is. That is one of the surprising things that makes the novel so engaging, of course, is that love affair. It's really quite beautiful. Would you mind reading a passage from the novel? Anything you'd like?
Well, I might just start from the very beginning because I didn't choose a passage. Well, I didn't know, you know, what would seem interesting. So I'll read a few pages. The child was just there on the stoop in the dark, hugging herself against the cold, all cried out and nearly sleeping. She couldn't holler anymore, and they didn't hear her anyway, or they might, and that would make things worse. Somebody had shouted, "Shut that thing up or I'll do it," and then a woman grabbed her out from under the table by her arm and pushed her out onto the porch and shut the door, and the cats went under the house. They wouldn't let her near them anymore because she picked them up by their tails sometimes. Her arms were all over scratches, and the scratches stung. She had crawled under the house to find the cats, but even when she did catch one in her hands, it struggled harder the harder she held onto it, and it bit her, so she let it go. "Why you keep pounding on that screen door? Nobody gonna let you, nobody gonna want you around if you act like that." And then the door closed again, and after a while, night came. The people inside fought themselves quiet, and it was night for a long time. She was afraid to be under the house and afraid to be up on the stoop, but if she stayed by the door, it might open. There was a moon staring straight at her, and there were sounds in the woods, but she was nearly sleeping when Dahl came up the path and found her like that, miserable as could be, and took her up in her arms and wrapped her into her shawl and said, "Well, we got no place to go. Where are we gonna go?" If there was anyone in the world the child hated most, it was Dahl. She'd go scrubbing at her face with a wet rag, or she'd be after her hair with a busted comb trying to get the snarls out. Dahl slept at the house most nights, and maybe she paid for it by sweeping up a little. She was the only one who did any sweeping, and she'd be cussing while she did it. "Don't do one damn bit of good," somebody would say. "Then leave it be," or pardon me, and someone would say, "Then leave it be, damn it." There'd be people sleeping right on the floor in some old mess of quilts and gunny sacks. You wouldn't know from one day to the next. When the child stayed under the table, they would forget her most of the time. The table was shoved into a corner, and they wouldn't go to the trouble of reaching under to pull her out of there if she stayed quiet enough. When Dahl came in at night, she would kneel down and spread her shawl over her, but then she left again so early in the morning that the child would feel this, these lights make it a little difficult to read. The child would feel the shawl slip off, and she'd feel colder for the lost warmth of it, and stir and cuss a little, but there would be hardtack, an apple, something, and a cup of water left there for her when she woke up. Once there was a kind of toy. It was just a horse chestnut with a bit of cloth over it, tied with a string, and two knots at the side and two at the bottom, like hands and feet. The child whispered to it and slept with it under her shirt.
It's really haunting.
Thank you.
not the voice we said goodbye to in Home. Tell us about this narrator's voice, this impressionistic voice.
Well, I wanted to be able to write things that I could take very seriously in very plain language. One of the oldest impulses in English and American literature is to try to get back to the sort of uncluttered functional poetry of, you know, of natural English. And I know there are 1,000 problems with that formula, but I had used language and enjoyed using language in Gilead and also in Home that would be current among people that were educated and especially theologically educated. And I wanted to use another palette than that. I wanted to use another language. And that was a lot of the interest for me of writing in her voice.
It's not the first person, but it's close in a way, isn't it?
Yes.
I'm not sure how to describe. Can you describe the way you approached that?
Well, if this were a workshop, I'd say it's close third.
Okay.
And so is Home.
And so it approximates the child's impressionistic vision of what's going on around her.
Yes.
Which makes it a little cloudy for us to figure out what's going on at times, just as she experiences. Mm-hmm. There were rumors of a fourth novel?
Yes. I've heard those rumors.
You already turned me down off the record. Now that I have you trapped here, maybe John Ames' son? Is that possible?
Well, frankly, he has not emerged on a page at this point.
What? What draws you back to this period, 50 or 60 years ago? What is it about that moment and that remote to us geographical place?
You know, that's an interesting question.
Finally. I've got I'm just sweating up here.
It's a strange thing. I started a novel when I was in college, actually, and it was set in a town in the Middle West, a small town. I'd never been in the Middle West. I'd never, you know, and that little town that didn't exist has haunted me all this time. It even has the river and the whole thing. I threw that novel away. It was terrible. But
oh, we'll find it someday. There'll be money to be made someday.
Yes, exactly. Well, in any case, it's sort of predestined in a way. I like to write about a time where people had less access to each other. More privacy in that sense. There's a kind of solitude that I think that was necessarily present in a great many lives a great deal of the time because we could not be reached all constantly the way that we are now, you know? I think it maybe made people experience differently and think differently. I'm sort of interested in that. I like people who think long thoughts.
What comes to you first as you conceive of a novel? Is it the plot, the characters, a voice?
It's a voice, really. A voice and a landscape, which they seem to be simultaneous. I knew Ruth's voice from the qualities of the landscape I knew I would be writing about. And the same is true with John Ames, who was visited upon me, you know, I was thinking of something else.
There's been a fairly intense debate about the amount of critical attention that women novelists get in comparison to male novelists. You get widely reviewed everywhere and you win important prizes, but do you notice this disparate attention to men and women?
Well, you know, I don't necessarily notice the attention I don't weigh it that way. I do think it's much, much easier for a male writer to be treated as a serious writer. Hmm. I think that the separate category of woman writer is marginal, you know, in a way, granting many very important women writers.
Yes. you work with the kind of writers that we'll be reading, you know, over the next few decades. Are you encouraged by what you see? Are you seeing a lot of talented, fresh voices?
Absolutely.
And can you make someone a better storyteller? I mean, this is your profession, but what does that process involve? Teaching someone to write better?
Well, first of all, you find somebody talented to teach. We find all sorts of, I mean, in a big year, we will have 1,300 applications for 25 places.
Oh.
So, you know, I mean, heaven knows, I mean, we wring our hands over the number of talented people we have to pass by.
Sure.
But it's like teaching any art. You know, you find someone who could be a dancer and you help her to be a better dancer, or, you know, painter, or violinist, whatever. People get in their own way. They don't, you know, they don't understand how to keep a narrative moving, for example, something like that. You know, what kind of characterization is important and what part should be, you know. So you're basically sort of, they give you what they produce, you look at it, you advise them the best way that you can. That's basically what you're doing. It's an art school. That's how it really should be understood.
And you're not creating young people to write books like yours.
Well, you know, I don't think that I do that. No. I mean, no.
And I've read books by your famous students, and they're radically different than yours.
Radically different, yes. I'm very proud of that.
You should be. Would you mind taking... I know people want to ask you questions of their own. Would you mind taking some questions?
I'd love to.
There's a mic here and here. It's very hard for us to see, so
yes.
just begin.
Thank you for being here. I would like to ask you, the Gilead. How, why, and your expectations in not having chapters or titles? What was your object?
My not having chapters?
Yes.
I just think chapters seem very unnatural to me. I've never written a book with chapters. The chapters in Housekeeping were put in by an editor. I don't know why, but it, I mean, often, like when I'm doing a reading, I think if I had chapters, I could find the place, you know? But when I'm writing, it just seems very, very artificial to me, would distract me.
We'll just switch back and forth.
I teach home. I love home, and for the final exercise with seniors in high school, I asked them to try to imitate your style and write a final chapter. They can't imitate your style, but I promised one of my students I would ask this. Her final chapter said, I know Marilynne Robinson would not do this, but I have to make Jack be happy. So she brought him back and his wife back at the end. Is there happiness for Jack? Is there a chance that part of the fourth book will deal with some happiness for Jack?
You know, that's kind of a problem, really. I mean, I lost my mother just a couple of years ago, but every time I talked to her on the telephone, which was virtually every night, she would worry about Jack. But, you know, I don't know what to do about that. I can't have this predetermined ending, you know.
Hi, thank you for being here. I love all your books.
Thank you.
I was curious, in Home, the relationship between Jack and Grace is so interesting, and yet their siblings are there as part of their world and how the two of them relate. And I just don't know, how did you do that? How did you make us understand all of those sibling relationships while really focusing in on Jack and Grace?
All right.
Oh, sorry.
I'm glad if I did it. It's, you know, you nudge words along, you know, and if you have the effect that you want when you're done, that's a wonderful thing.
Thank you. I'm continuing the theme on questions about Jack. He's such a remarkable character, but when I was reading the book, I kept seeing that character through the lens of our modern day thoughts about addiction and recovery. But that doesn't, you know, the characters in the novel don't seem to, I mean, because of the time period, don't seem to see him through those lenses at all. And I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about that character and alcoholism. Mm.
That's an interesting question. I think that perhaps we have developed a very firm notion of normality, which really means functionality for us, perhaps, you know? This sort of tenuous quality of Jack's character, his scant hold on life in a certain sense, is simultaneous with his alcoholism. I can't really imagine the character without that being certainly an active pull for him, an active, recourse in a way, because he finds many things painful. I don't know. If there were a living contemporary Jack, I don't know if he would be particularly successfully dealt with by our attempts at curing addiction and so on.
We heard in the introduction that you've done some preaching, and I was just wondering if the way you preach, you write it for preaching, is different or similar, and if you've thought about publishing any of your sermons.
I'm here to tell you that I will not publish any of my sermons. They went the way of the college novel. I study theology and write about theology, and so people think, oh, we need somebody to give a sermon. Let's ask Marilynne. And since, this is usually done because there's some sort of emergency, some need, I do it, and it always goes very badly.
No, that's hard to believe.
Oh, well, you're very kind. Please never come to any sermon. I don't want to disillusion you. But it is odd, but I take it to be the cosmos telling me I do not belong in a pulpit.
I think that's basically my question. I just graduated from seminary, and so I was going to ask you your secrets for writing sermons. And maybe my main question is, how do you bring your storytelling gifts into that kind of storytelling and call? I'm just curious how you see some of that.
I wish I could tell you how I did that. I wish I could tell you long stories of success in that particular regard, but I don't. I love these stories. Abraham and Sarah are wonderful. Adam and Eve are wonderful. But pulpits make me so nervous that I don't basically carry over my enthusiasms into the pulpit.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And good luck.
She doesn't need luck. She is God.
That's true.
Good morning, good afternoon. I would like you to talk a bit about the Midwest and its impact on your life and your writing. True confessions, I'm born and bred from Minneapolis. I've lived here for 30 years. I'm still deeply rooted in the Midwest. I'd love to hear you talk about whether your writing has to take place where it does, if there's special things about the landscape that you just can't separate out from your writing.
I think it's sort of true, but I never know these things for certain, but I think it is true that I probably will write about that region for as long as I continue writing. Things happen that surprise you. I thought I would not write a novel from a male point of view. And then I had this man's voice in my head, so you never know. But I read a lot of history of the Middle West when I first moved there. I only went there because I was invited to come to the workshop to teach. And that's such a sort of mythic establishment, that I had to do it. And there I was in Iowa, and I had to learn to read the landscape. I had to learn to understand it because I'd grown up in the mountains. I'd lived in the Berkshires. You get these. And so I did. I studied it. I read about the patterns of settlement and so on. It's very beautiful. And when you get so that you actually can see the prairie, that's very beautiful. But I spent years, because I loved being there. I mean, I loved the teaching I was doing and the people I was meeting and all the rest of it. But I wanted my soul to love the landscape, you know? So I made quite a discipline of that. The Audubon Society was my good friend. And it's the longest human narrative that I know well, that the abolitionist movement, the foundation of all the little colleges, those wonderful little colleges that are all over the landscape. You know, this sort of high achievement and very little pretentiousness, which is a lovely combination and seems very Middle Western to me.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much for everything that you've written. I'd like to ask you a question about Gilead. 10 years ago, a few of my friends and I, we read the book together, and since then, we've found it kind of inescapable. Every time we're talking to each other about a major life decision, I'm thinking of getting married, and I was thinking about this passage from Gilead. I'm thinking of becoming a pastor, and I was thinking about this passage from Gilead. I've been battling depression, but then I thought about this passage from Gilead, and we've all read it several times since, and we've found the book completely inescapable. So we don't find that a bad thing, but I wanted to ask you if you have thoughts, suggestions, maybe even warnings for people who can't seem to stop living inside your book.
All I can say is I hope I gave you a congenial, humane book to live in. I'd like to give you another one just to sort of expand the world for you.
Thank you.
I grew up on a farm in southern Minnesota, just 6 miles from Iowa. My brother and his wife are both pastors. I liked your comment just now about the lack of pretentiousness, because that is very, very real. So if you could speak about that for just a minute, I'd appreciate that.
If I could expand on it, you say?
If you could say a little bit more about the lack of pretentiousness that you feel in the people in your books, in that area in particular.
You meet some very distinguished people. It's a very hard thing to say, to explain, but there are no signals of status, you know? I mean, there are no... people, there's very little display in anything that people do. It's very, they very quietly, in many cases, are very excellent at some very difficult thing. And you have to sort of know this obliquely, you know. It's just something that is certainly where I lived and people that I've known, very characteristic. I don't want to say dismissive things about, you know, people in other places, but... You know, I mean, people don't flaunt anything.
I find out things about my family from other people.
Yeah.
Because they don't tell about their accomplishments.
Exactly, exactly. That's very characteristic.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Hi, good afternoon. I teach high school religion and philosophy, and it's a particularly tough audience, especially for those disciplines. And I found both your fiction and your nonfiction to be very useful to getting access to high school kids, strangely enough. And I know you draw a lot on John Calvin, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Karl Barth. I'm wondering if there are any contemporary theological voices that have been informing your current thought, especially as you unpack something like in Lila and her character.
Yeah, well, you know, it sounds terrible for me to say no, but, you know, it seems to me as if there's a lot of very classic theology that is foundational and that has been lost track of. And there's a sort of, in many cases, a sort of weakening of the tradition, a sort of, you know, loss of the humanist magnificence that it's capable of. So I tend to be looking, you know, to Karl Barth or earlier.
I'm curious about some of your students. Can you talk a little bit about some that we should have heard about or will soon hear about?
Well, you know, I mean, so far only one of them has won a Pulitzer Prize.
Slacker.
Paul Harding wrote a book called Thinkers. Ian Mathis is a student of mine, has been a student of mine. It's terrible. People always blank. I always blank when I think of trying to list names. And you have the list and won't help me.
No, I don't. I'm sorry.
Zizi Packer is a former student of mine. I don't know who you would have heard of.
Well, I guess the question is, who should we have heard of?
Yeah. Well, lots of them. Lots of them.
Thank you.
I'm a little awed by standing here. I've read Gilead 3 times, and I'm not a religious person. So I have nothing but compliments for your ability to weave a subtle, complementary novel about things that are inner as well as daily. And I know you've gotten the compliments from all of the critics, but you need to know that the real people out there are listening also. And I'm looking forward to your next book, which is apparently coming out soon, a collection of essays. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, my essays are actually always a collection of lectures that I've given. Two of these are lectures that I gave at the Divinity School at Edinburgh in Scotland. There are things that are on my mind. There's always this strong coherence in my essays, and there ought not to be, because I think I'm lecturing on different subjects. When I put them together, they're about, you know, contemporary culture, Shakespeare. There's some Shakespeare essays in there. Theology, you know, of course it's a theological view of Shakespeare, probably a sort of Shakespearean view of theology. But anyway, I think they're worth reading.
Well, my compliments again.
Well, thank you very much.
Just one more question, I'm sorry.
Ms. Robinson, more than theosophical tenets and doctrines, I find a lot of poetic intensity in your works. And kind of, if you could trace the connection between poetry and prose, and if you have any message for, concerning poetry to prose writers / novelists and to poets about writing, about prose writing. Thank you.
Well, there's an element in the 19th century American tradition which interests me very much, which is this sort of Emersonian tradition or Thoreau, that where prose borders on poetry, it works from the logic of poetry. And Emily Dickinson, she crosses the line. I mean, she's on the other side, but dealing with the same subject. I wanted to write poetry. I considered prose to be the sort of consolation prize for my inability to write poetry. But there are ways in which, particularly figurative language, carries meaning beyond the explicit meaning, And I think that when I'm writing fiction, I'm always trying to push the language beyond flat meaning, to sort of put another spin, which I consider to be similar to the impulse that moves poetry. I think that the distinction between the two is sharper than, conventionally sharper than it is intrinsically sharp, I think that, I think more narrative in poetry would often be a good thing, a little answer to the obscurity that's so often characteristic. And I think more poetry in prose would be a good thing, because it makes language do more.
It's been such a pleasure to have you here. Thank you very much for coming.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.